church, there's something about fellowship with my brother. Something about gathering in the house of the Lord. Something about
church.
Good morning and welcome to Christ Baptist Church in Burlington, New Jersey. There is something about church when the called out ones of God gather to share His victories in their lives. In this season, we boldly acknowledge that the building is not the church. You and I, we're the church, and today and every day, the church is open. Today, we meet through electronic media to defy the prince of the power of the air, with the authority of the King of the air and everything, Jesus the Christ. Certainly we miss the smiles, handshakes, and hugs of all our brothers and sisters, but we will not be hindered in meeting and gathering together to worship. Please get your Bibles along with your family and neighbors to join you in a Holy Ghost worship experience.
I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Let's sound glad. Come on.
Glory. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We praise you, God, and we thank you. We magnify your name, and we're so honored, Lord, that you have given us more time to give praise to you. Thank you, Lord, for this morning's early rising. Thank you for traveling mercies that brought us here safely to this time of worship. And as we entered into the gates, we came in with thanksgiving. We came in with a heart of praise. We came in to honor you, the fruit of our lips, giving praise, glory, and honor to your name. And Lord God, now we're passing aside all things that would take our mind, our attention off of worshiping you. We put it away now, Lord, as we look heavenward. And thank you, God, for watching out for us this week. We could go by the hour. We could go by the day. We could go by portions of the week, but we thank you for every moment this week, God. You walk with us and you talk with us and you guided us, you protected us, you provided for us. Oh, God, we got praises for you. We praise you for how well we feel and we praise you for clarity of mind. Oh, God, we got praises for you. And we praise you, Lord, in this day. God, we're asking your blessings, your anointing power upon those of our church that are sick, Lord, those who may be listening, who may not be feeling so well. But God, I pray right now that you would lift their spirits. We pray now, God, you would give them just a few hours, God, where they can give praise to your name. If they're hurting, let them raise their hands. They can speak, let them utter with their voices, hallelujah, to our holy God. Bless our worship today, God. And Lord God, we give you all glory, praise, and honor. In the name of your son, Jesus, we thank you. Amen. Amen. Come on, praise God. Praise God. Praise God. This time we're going to have our morning scripture reading. I ask if you'd stand. Stand for our scripture reading. Minister Lorraine Taylor is coming for our morning scripture reading. And such a joyous thing to be in the house of the Lord.
Hello? Hallelujah. All right, we can hear it now. Okay, I'll be reading from Matthew chapter 12, verses 22 to 30. And it reads thus. Then was brought unto him one possessed with a devil, blind and dumb. He healed him insomuch that the blind and dumb both spake and saw. And all the people were amazed and said, is not this the son of David? But when the Pharisees heard it, they said, this fellow doth not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, the prince of the devils. And Jesus knew their thoughts and said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. If Satan cast out Satan, he is divided against himself. How shall then his kingdom stand? And if I, by Beelzebub, cast out devils, by whom do your children cast them out? Therefore, they shall be your judges. But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God is come unto you. Or else how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he first bind the strong man? Then he will spoil his house. He that is not with me is against me, and he that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad. Praise God.
Amen. Let us all remain standing as we sing this opening selection together. You know the words, sing along with us. Seated. At this time, we're going to ask Deacon Ken Thorne if he'd come and give us our expressions of welcome.
Good morning. Good morning. Just want to welcome everybody. It's been a little while since we were all here, able to gather together. We want to thank the Lord because he made a way. If it was not for the Lord to move those mountains and to cause walls to fall that the devil had set up to cause us not to hear the word, we thank the Lord that he was able to do that. Welcome you all of those that are online listening right now. We welcome you. We thank the Lord for you. Continue to listen. If you're not able to get here in the house, continue to listen and watch it live online because the Lord is good. Amen.
Good morning, all. I just wanted to ditto what my husband said. Welcome, and I missed you all. Glad to be in the house one more time. Continue to hold us up in prayer and welcome. Glad to see you.
Time, we're going to have some announcements. Let's give heed to the screen.
Electronic giving is fast, easy, and convenient. There are three ways to give: online giving, mobile app, or text. Tithes and donations may also be mailed to Christ Baptist Church, P.O. Box 10, Burlington, New Jersey, 08016. This information can also be found on our website.
Here are your announcements for today.
Uh-huh. There is power in prayer. Please remember in your prayers all those on our prayer list. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. Psalms 25, 1. Happy birthday and anniversary blessings to all those celebrating in the month of May. Congratulations to Deaconess Stacy Diggs for earning her Doctor of Educational Leadership degree from Liberty University, Lynchburg, Virginia. Congratulations to Professor Karen Turner on her recent honor from Temple University for her achievement in celebration of her teaching, research, service, and creative achievement. Well done, women of God.
Hello, Christ Baptist family. I hope you are all doing well during these trying times. On May 22nd, JAM is hosting another snack drive, and we are collecting juice boxes, snack cakes, pies, candy, nuts, cookies, popcorn, and chips to support the CBC and FBC feed ministry. All items must be individually wrapped. They will be collected in the front circle of the church on May 22nd from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. See you there.
Join us for our Women's Day celebration on May the 30th at 10 a.m. Our theme is Mask, Moving Ahead, Shielded by the King. Our guest preacher will be the Reverend Kimberly Coleman. Registration is required for in-house service. Please visit our website. Remember that God in His Word has promised that He will never leave us nor forsake us. God bless you.
Father, we thank you, Lord, for the gifts of your people. We thank you for their hearts that understand that they are to give as you have commanded in your word. You said, God, that if we bring the tithe to the storehouse, that you would open the windows of heaven. You'd pour us out a blessing that we would not have room enough to receive. You told us in Proverbs 3, God, that when we bring the first fruits to you, you would increase the fruit in our vine. You would help us keep what we already possess in our barns. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. Thank you for your graciousness and your gifts. We return it to you now. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. 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 Come on, give God praise. Just to make sure I don't forget anything, I'm going to look over at Sister Ramona so she can tell me what I forgot. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. The fifth Sunday. Fifth Sunday is Women's Day. Fifth Sunday, the 30th, is Women's Day. Fifth Sunday, May 30th, is Women's Day. Amen. So we're going to invite all of you. It is a registration. You go online. It's available right up on our website. You go up. You can register for Women's Day to be a part. We have guests coming. Reverend Kim Coleman out of First Baptist in Crestmont, powerful preacher, is going to be here with us. Let us mark our calendars. In your time of prayer, continue to pray for those persons who have the conditions are still in their bodies. And I was excited this week. Deacon Thompson texted me to say that they moved his mother. Sister Juanita is a cancer sufferer, but they moved her into rehabilitation. And so we're just praising God that he is still doing something in our midst. Continue to keep Sister Edwina in your prayers and continue to keep Sister Evelyn Williams in your prayers. Again, it's always great when she comes into the room and we can celebrate God that she's in our presence. Continue to pray for Brother Deacon Maurice Tools. He lost his sister, funeralizer on this week. Please continue to pray for him and to strengthen him. And he's a very dear brother. He's always faithful to be here. So let's lift him up before the Lord. Also remember Yvonne, Sister Ellis' daughter, Danny, and all of their family. We funeralized Brother Roland on Friday. And so let's remember to keep God before God that family, the Ellis family, that God would bless them during this time of loss. Please remember the family of Charles Harvey Jr. That's my cousin, his son. He funeralized him on yesterday, 39 years old. Pray that God will continue to strengthen their family. This song will lead us to our time of prayer.
This morning we can say hallelujah. Lord, I just thank you because of the fact that the enemy tried to stop me from coming this morning. I haven't had an asthma attack in almost 10 years, but I'm here because of your grace and mercy. I thank you, Lord. Father, I just so thank you for all those who are ringing the bells because of your grace and mercy, because of your favor, Lord, because you love us. Father, I just thank you also because of the fact that we have a church family who cares, who shares, and who loves. We thank you for Reverend Bogan and his wife, Lord. You knew exactly what we needed. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, for all those who are having recognized their prayers being answered. It's on its way. It's God's time, not our time. But we also thank you, too, for the fact that we have a government that's moving. We have people that are moving. We have people that are evangelizing, telling the word of Christ, because we know who Christ is. But most of all, Lord, you love us. You died on the cross to save us. And Father, regardless of what we may think, we are not in control. But we thank you today. We thank you anyway. We thank you for all things, great and small. You clothe us, you feed us, you give us shelter. Who else does that? We don't have to worry. So we turn around and say, Lord, thank you for strengthening us. Thank you for giving us all that we need. In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I'm gonna follow Jesus Christ.
God, we thank you that when it looked like we were losing, we should have trusted you, Lord, because we are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ our Lord. As much as we're tempted, as much as we're tried, we have victory in your Son, Jesus. And for that reason, God, we give you all glory, honor, and praise. Thank you, Lord, for how you keep us. Thank you for how you give us guidance in our lives. Have victory over the enemy. Now, Lord, I stand to proclaim your word. I seek fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit. Help me now, God, as I speak your word with clarity and with power. Speak to me and speak through me. Spirit of the living God, fall new and fall fresh. And we ask this in the matchless, mighty, and marvelous name of your Son, Jesus. Thank you, God. Amen. Amen. Come on, give God praise. Give God praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to invite you to turn with us this morning to Acts chapter 23. Amen. We thank God for our worship ministry. Praise God. Acts chapter 23. Thank you, Lord. Today we want to encourage those soldiers that have been fighting on the battlefield of the Lord, those who have, we've gone through some struggles. This war that we're fighting against an enemy that is not even visible. This war is real. And over 2,500 years ago, there was a Chinese military strategist named Sun Tzu. Sun Tzu wrote a book called The Art of War, still used by militaries even today. The training is there. And there's a section in Sun Tzu's Art of War called Laying Plans for Warfare. Laying Plans for Warfare. And in that, he talks about the fact that the soldiers on the field are governed by five constant factors that aid in deliberation considering the conditions in the field. There are five things that he raises in planning for the warfare. First of all is the moral law. And in the section on moral law, he talks about all the soldiers being in concord with the ruler, that the ruler sent you out to fight, and you can't make up your own mind what you're going to do. We just come out here to scare them. Now, you got, what did the ruler send you out for? We just came out here to kill somebody. No, what did the ruler send you out? He says the moral law says there has to be concord with the ruler. The second part of it was the commander. And in the commander portion of that training, he talked about the virtues of wisdom and sincerity and benevolence and strictness and all of the things that the commander brings to the table as he's leading soldiers in the field. The third thing he talks about is heaven. And when he talks about heaven, he's talking about night and day. He's talking about warm and cold. He's talking about times and seasons. We've got to be ready in the field to operate under whatever the heavens send toward us. The fourth thing is methods and discipline. And in methods and discipline, he talks about marshaling soldiers, getting them ready for the battle. He talks about the graduation of rank in the field. Corporals don't tell generals what to do. He talks about maintenance of infrastructure and supplies. As you're in this army, we've got to make sure we got what we need to do the job. The final part of the five parts in this section on preparing, laying plans for warfare, was a section called Earth. And in the section on Earth, he talked about things that are great and things that are small. He talked about danger and security. He talked about the possibility of death and how our life can continue. But there's a latter portion there that really is part of our lesson text today. He talked about open ground and narrow passes. Open ground and narrow passes. Acts chapter 23, verse number 12. Acts 23, verse 12. And when it was day, some of the Jews banded together and bound themselves under an oath, saying that they would neither eat nor drink till they had killed Paul. Now there were more than 40 who had formed this conspiracy. They came to the chief priests and elders and said, "We have bound ourselves under a great oath that we will eat nothing until we have killed Paul. Now you, therefore, together with the council, suggest to the commander that he be brought down to you tomorrow, as though you were going to make further inquiries concerning him. But we are ready to kill him before he comes near." So when Paul's sister's son heard of this ambush, he went and entered the barracks and told Paul. I'll talk this morning from the subject, conspiration, unlawful design. Conspiration, unlawful design. Sun Tzu says that there is moral law, there is commander, there is heaven, there is marshaling methods of discipline, and there is earth. In the latter part, he talked about open ground and narrow passes. It's that last part I told you we're going to talk about today. You see, it is there in the narrow passes where the enemy sets up ambushes. It is there where the enemy sets up some means of being able to trap or to hurt somebody. They set up ambushes. Ambushes are places of concealment. They are under dense underbrush. They are hiding behind hilltops. They're hiding in caves, camouflaged. When the enemy, when he sets up an ambush, he doesn't come out in the open. He does it in a very secretive kind of way in order that he can get advantage over his adversary. This text tells us that this method of war has been successful for years. Hannibal, anybody study a world history? Hannibal set up striking distance against the Romans, and he set up an ambush against them, and Hannibal won the battle. The Germanic war chief, Arminius, what he did was, he against the Romans at the Battle of Teutoburg Forest, he set up ambushes that he would win. When the Parthians came out against the Syrians, they set up ambushes in places where they would win, at Antigonia. You see, setting up ambushes does work, unless the person you're setting them up against has a greater reconnaissance program than you do. If all you got, you're working with human elements, you may be victorious. But when those of us that know God know that whenever the enemy tries to set up an ambush, God knows how to set up an ambushment. Y'all missing it. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, y'all know the text. In fact, the famous part out of the text is when Jehaziel said to Jehoshaphat, "This battle is not yours, it's the Lord." Y'all know that part, right? The Bible says in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 22, that Jehoshaphat took the choir. I love this text. He took the choir and put them in front of the army. Y'all gonna get this. He put the choir in front of the army. And the Bible says that as the choir began to lift up praise, God set up ambushments against the children of Moab, against the Ammonites, and against the Edomites. Now you gotta grab this. There's a difference between ambush and ambushments. Ambush is an action. Ambushment, anytime you put "ment" onto a word, it turns an action into an act. And so while they were trying to come against God's people, he set up ambushments. God thing, and it's when you take an action and turn it into an act that results out of the action, God says, whatever the enemy is trying to do, it won't work because I've already given you victory over his ambush. The text lets us know that God is the one who brings victory. The last time we were together, we were looking at Paul as he sat before the Sanhedrin. And in that text, and we were ended at verse 11 last time, in that text, Paul noticed that there was a schism. There was an intestine schism that went on between the Sanhedrin between the Sadducees and the Pharisees. Y'all remember that from last week? A couple people over here did. The rest of y'all, let me tell you, they were arguing because some of them believed in the resurrection of the dead. Others did not believe. Paul noticed that that difference was there, and it created them started fighting with each other. That's where we left off last week. But we can understand that when these schisms come, as he met before this great legislative and legal body, Paul understood something, that when God is fighting for us, it's more than everybody else against us. In fact, if you've ever been in this battle for any time, you know that even though it seems like the enemy's army is larger than yours, it's you and God always is greater than everything the enemy throws against you. In June of 1858, 1,000 Republicans met and legislators met in Springfield, Illinois. And in that meeting, they chose Abraham Lincoln to represent them in the Senate. And when Abraham Lincoln was chosen that night, he gave a speech. And the speech contained the phrase, "A house divided against itself cannot stand." That phrase Abe Lincoln got out of the Bible. It appears in the three synoptic gospels. Jesus declared, "A house divided against itself cannot stand." His legal partner, William Herndon, said to Abe Lincoln, "I don't think you need to bring that up. I think you just need to pass on and say something else." Lincoln says, "I'm saying this." And this is what he says. He says, "A house divided against itself cannot stand. I believe this government cannot endure permanently half slave and half free. I don't think we can make it with one part this and one part that," Lincoln said. He says, "I do not expect the Union to be dissolved. I do not expect the House to fall. But I do expect that it will cease to be divided." Lincoln says, "My anticipation is this divided thing can't go on." He says, "It will either become one thing or it become another." Beloved, listen, Lincoln, whatever you want to think about him, Lincoln understood this right out of the Word of God. A house divided cannot stand. And if you understand real quick, in the backdrop of Jesus making this declaration, Matthew and in Luke, in the backdrop, there was a demon-controlled man that was brought to Jesus. And the Bible does not tell us who brought the demon-controlled man. But let me tell you what the Bible does tell us. The Bible says in verse number 22, they brought it to Jesus. And it's believed the "they" in verse 22 is the "they" in verse 14 of Matthew chapter 12. They plotted against Jesus to destroy him. They brought the demon-controlled man. Now, here's why. They want to discredit Jesus. They bring a man to Jesus that is blind and mute. And they bring him so that Jesus can see what kind of miracle he can do. Remember, everyone that Jesus spoke to and did a miracle, they were able to carry it out. But if we bring him a blind man and we bring him a mute man, let's see what Jesus can do. The Bible is very strange as we're looking at the text because it's hard to communicate with him. He can't see what signs you're making. He can't hear what you're doing. The man was blind and he was mute. The Bible tells us, though, that Jesus healed the man. Now, let me help you understand this. The text of Scripture says he removed the impediment to the sight and to the speech. He removed the demon out of the man. Soon as he got the impediment out of the way, the man could see and the man could speak. Y'all missing this? Listen, as long as the problem is there, the circumstance will still be there. The Bible says he got the demon out. And there's four miracles in this two little verses. Four miracles. First of all, Jesus is able to help blind people see. You know about it. One day you and I were blind, but now we see. Jesus in this miracle was able to help dumb people speak. There are words that we couldn't utter before, but now we've got a praise on our lips offered up to God. Jesus was able to take a possessed man and leave him delivered by the power of God. Blind man saw, the dumb man spoke, and the possession is gone. But finally, an intruder is dismissed out of the man. You see, there was somebody camped up in the man that should not have been there. Anytime you let the devil squat in your house, the devil's going to create havoc in your house. You've got to get the devil out. Jesus got him out. Now, here's the rest of the story real fast. After Jesus got the devil out, the demon out, they accused Jesus of doing miraculous works through the work of Satan. They called him. They said, you did this through Beelzebul, the Canaanite god, the lord of the flies. I know you're in the city of Burlington, but out in the country where I lived, anytime we saw flies, we knew something dead was around. Anytime we saw the parasite, the fly, we knew something was stinking in the territory. They called Jesus the Lord of the flies, the Lord of that which hangs around dead things. But how do you say to he who is the God of the living that you're the Lord of flies? Problem in the text. Because the problem, the tension in the text, Jesus was accused of performing his miracles by a Canaanite God and not by Jehovah God. By calling him the prince of devils, two things are implied. One, it implies that the enemies of the Lord were unable to deny that one, a miracle had occurred. The man was healed. He was blind, he was dumb, now he can see, he can talk. A miracle did take place. But the second thing is, they did believe in an organized kingdom of evil. And they thought that Jesus ruled it. But I love verse 25 of that text. The text says, Jesus knew their thoughts. Pause. Park. Whatever you and I are thinking, Jesus already knows it. And if you think that you're going to be judged by what you say, that's not the issue. The issue is whatever you're thinking is already that which came up out of your heart. Jesus knew their thoughts. He knew what was revolving in their minds. Jesus knew he saw the secrets of their hearts. And the Bible says he called them and he defended his authority. Now it's interesting. This is one of the few places in the Bible where Jesus defended his authority. He defended his authority and he says to them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation. Whenever there is a kingdom that is warring against itself, it's laid to waste, Jesus says. He says, and every city, every household, every church, every county, including Burlington, it's in here. I'm reading between the lines. Every city that is divided shall not abide. He gave three arguments to disprove their claim. First argument was this. If I was working by the power of Satan and I have defeated him, then Satan is working against himself. What kind of nonsense is that? That the devil would work against himself? He may, because he's not that bright. Few things are sadder than a powerful kingdom that is destroyed by contention. There's very few things that are sadder than that. When you've got a team that's working together, you see it in sports all the time. When everybody is just a nobody, the Detroit Pistons was a great example of that. There were no stars on that team, just a bunch of people that got together and played hard, and they were champions. The moment somebody thinks, I've got to have the ball, I get to make most shots, that team is going down. And so Jesus says, the Satan can't be working against himself. It can't be divided. Second thing he says is, look, you got some of your own contemporaries that can exorcise demons. Are they doing it by the power of the devil? The third thing he says is that by driving out the demons, I've proven that I am greater than Satan. Now, beloved, he proved that their reasoning was faulty. He proved that their reasoning was illogical. Their reasoning was impractical because a house divided against itself cannot stand. Come back. Come back to our text. Paul meets before the Sanhedrin. And the Sanhedrin is arguing amongst themselves. And the text says, look at it because this is really good. The text says that the next day they came out against Paul. When I see the next day, it helps me understand that there were some meetings that went on last night in order to do what we're doing today. I've been in church long enough. I've been Baptist long as I've been in church. And I've understood always that there's always three meetings. There's the meeting before the meeting. There's the meeting itself. And there's the meeting after the meeting. Come on, y'all been in church long enough to see it yourself. There's always three meetings. And so that last night, after the night was over, the Bible says they came forward when it was daylight, they came forward with a plot. What we're dealing with here, beloved, is we're dealing with a confederacy that forms a conspiracy. And this whole idea of this confederacy coming together, there's a stark difference between a confederacy and a collaboration. A collaboration is when people work together for a common goal. But a confederacy is when you get alien forces coming together against an organized state in order to turn it over. That's why the Confederacy was that which led the war and the Civil War from the South. They were trying to overturn the United States of America. And here's what Aaron Dean, in a peer review, academic peer review, on why Confederates fought. Interesting reading. Aaron Dean says that, first of all, the majority of the people who fought in the Civil War were not slaveholders. Why were they fighting? They weren't fighting about slaves. Why were the majority of the people not slaveholders? And the idea that he brings forth is that they were fought for personal, for familial, for communal, and for religious obligations. That's the same thing we're being told today. That people are fighting because I want to keep my family. They're fighting because they want to keep the community. They're fighting because they think there's a religious obligation. Same thing they're fighting, that we see it going on right now. Whenever there's a confederacy, there's an overlapping motivation. And that overlapping motivation usually comes out as a guise for defense of home and for honor. Beloved, this confederacy was forming. And when you see this confederacy, in fact, the word conspiracy in our text, you see it? Y'all see the word conspiracy? They formed this conspiracy. Conspiracy comes from a Latin word, conspiare. And conspiare means to breathe together. Guess what the word means? To breathe together. Now, in music, that works great. We ought to all breathe together in order that we hold our note together, that we play our instruments together. If you have multiple instruments, you breathe together. But in the case of life, when this kind of conspiracy is going on, it is caustic, and it will wear that society down. They formed this conspiracy, this mob mentality rose up, this herd mentality, this gang mentality, this pack mentality was raised up in our text. And here's the amazing thing. They were not even in yesterday's session with the Sanhedrin. But they got up the next morning, and they're mad enough to declare, we're not going to eat nor drink until Paul is dead. How do you grab that? They made up their minds under an oath that we will not eat nor drink until Paul is dead. Well, I want to give you some thoughts, because these revolutionary-minded Jews raises some things that may help us out, even in our living. That if we notice the depth of the hatred and the nature of their plans, the text says they rose up early. What the text says is that they couldn't even sleep last night. They were so bent on hurting and killing Paul that they couldn't even sleep. They rose up early. But beloved, can I share something with you? I don't care how early they got up. He that keepeth Israel neither slumbers nor sleeps. While they were up trying to figure it out, God had already worked it out. The depth of the hatred and the nature of the plan is that they rose up early to carry it out. Secondly, this kind of hatred is always bound with some kind of oath or some kind of curse. The curse is they want to inflict something that will cause harm, the curse that they want to bring. But can I suggest something to you this morning? There's only one person that can put a curse on, and only one person that can take a curse off, and that's God. Miss Beulah can send you all the hair
and powder she want from down south. You can't curse nobody that God does not curse. You tell Miss Beulah, hold on to it, because it just won't work. I need a eye of a toad. Mucus from a newt. Some soot and some of Miss Beulah's powder. And I'm going to put it by your doorstep. And you're going to be in trouble. Beloved, how foolish does that sound? When I got God covering me, looking out for me, why would I worry about what Beulah can cook up? It always brings a curse. But can I suggest something to you? Curses are like chickens. They always come home to roost. The curse you think you're putting on somebody else, it's coming right back at you. So the depth of the hatred and the nature of the plot is that there's a binding by a curse. Third thing I want, as we look at the text, this kind of hatred demands satisfaction even to the point of personal deprivation. Can I tell you something? And some of you, we've all been there, maybe all of us have been there, some of us. We've had such bitterness and such anger and such unforgiveness inside of us that the other person's going through life skipping and we're all upset about how we feel about them. You see them and they're grinning and you mad inside. Can I suggest something? That poison is going to come back and poison you, because that hatred is not damaging them. Their life goes on. The third thing we understand about the depth of this hatred and the nature of this plan is that it is injurious. It is injurious and it's injudicious. This plan is injurious and injudicious. That the 40 men came together and they had, can I suggest something to you? When you get 40 people, you got 40 opinions. It's hard to get a couple people trying to come up with the same idea, moving in the same direction. That's why God sets up headships. That's why God puts people in place to lead things. Everybody can't be leading. You all can have an opinion, but everybody's got to follow a lead, because it's God that gives direction. It is God who is the shepherd. It is the pastor who is the under-shepherd. And we've got to understand we're following the lead of God in everything that we do. Fifth thing is this kind of hatred is prompt and it's energetic. They hadn't really thought this thing through. If you go back and study the history of this man, Paul, I heard when he was down in jail in Philippi and they thought we were going to kill him, somebody told me he was down there singing. I don't get it. We put him down in the deepest dungeon, and he's down there singing and praying to his God. The enemy don't understand that when he thinks he's got us, all we got to do is go down on our knees in prayer. We've got to perfume our prayer with praise. We've got to lift up glory to God in the midst of what we're going through. Finally, the thing I learned in this text, when I'm looking at the depth of the hatred, when looking at the nature of this plot, I learned that it depends on lies and deceit, underhandedness, and unscrupulous means. The enemy, there is no place he will not go to try and bring you down. You ever have somebody tell you something on somebody else? I know him. I remember when he used to always be over at Sam's Bar. And then he'd leave Sam's Bar and go over to the Bucket of Blood. And when he got over to the Bucket of Blood, there was this little girl over there. He always met her over there. His wife don't know it. The person who tells you stories about somebody else, do they ever tell you stories about themselves? Did they ever tell you how they knew he was at the Bucket of Blood? Do they ever say, you know, I was a liar and a scoundrel and a wretch undone too. But let me tell you about him. People who are deceitful, people who are liars, people who are underhanded. I heard somebody tell me one time, that word liar, you shouldn't use that word. It's a strong word. I said, let me see if I can get them to understand something. People who sing are singers. People who dance are dancers. People who lie. The text says, under the pretense of sending for Paul to question him. They tried to get other people involved in the plot. Told the chief priest, y'all, let's say you're going to bring him back for questioning. And when you bring him back for questioning, here's a narrow place. Let's bring him back for questioning. We will ambush him and we will kill him. Beloved, what I understand about God, and you know it too now, that in this battle that we're fighting, our God is greater than any enemy that's going to come against us. Our God can do more than you and I could ever think that God can do. First of all, God strengthens his servants. God gives us eternally a promise of his grace, and we hold on to it. God reveals the designs of the enemy. We may not know all the details of the plot, but God exposes the plot. You may not know how we know, but there's a God in heaven that makes the plot known. God, the text says, stirs up people to let us know that there's a plot going on. Look at the text. Paul's nephew. By the way, it's the first time we even find out that Paul had a sister. Paul's nephew came and told him, Uncle Paul, I heard that they're trying to hurt you, and you need to watch out. The Bible says that he came and he told Paul, and Paul, when he told the Roman leaders, Lysias, we learned in verse 27 of the text, you read it later, Lysias says, I'm going to get him out of there because God has set me in this place in order that I can deliver him. Beloved, when you understand that when conspiration, when these unlawful designs are coming against us, our God is a very present help to give us direction to everything that the enemy's going. The further you are away from God, you may not hear him. But when you get close enough to God, when you walk with him and talk with him, God advises your heart that something is not right. Something is going on. And when God advises you, you don't even have to fight it. This battle's not ours. This battle's the Lord. I start praising God. And as I start praising him, anybody here ever have God serenade their soul? It's marvelous when you get a serenade from God and he starts speaking to your soul. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will always be with you. Whatever is coming against you, Paul in our text, God gives a serenade to his soul and gets him out of the burden that he was in. He set up ambushments against the enemy, and they never win, because knowing that God is on our side, we have victory in Jesus. No matter what the enemy tries, we have victory in Jesus. If there's anyone here today who does not know Christ as Lord, as Savior, as Commander, as Pioneer of your soul, if you don't know him, today is the day you need to give your life to him. And I want to encourage you, as Paul was, that as I'm traveling on this journey, God does sing serenades to my soul. He tells me, I'm not going to leave you. I didn't bring you this far for you to be knocked down. I know the enemy's going to come. You know that he's going to come against you, but I'm going to be with you. All you have to do is admit you are a sinner. If anyone out there that's unsaved, admit that you're a sinner. Admit you don't have God on your side. Admit that if you were to die right now, you have no idea where you spend eternity. Admit it. If you will admit it and believe in your heart that God sent his son Jesus to die on a cross to reconcile us back to himself, if you will believe that God did that for you, if you simply will confess, I was a conspirator, I was a liar, I was deceitful, I was walking contrary to God. If you will admit it, believe it, and confess it, the Bible says you can be saved. The number on the screen, call that number and say, I really want God to sing a song to my soul, because I don't want to live life like I'm living it anymore. I want God in my life. Stand to your feet as we give this invitation. With him, or you can have the confidence to know that in the midst of your trouble, he'll sing a serenade to your soul. Is there one here today? I invite you to come down front. So I want to give my life to Christ. I'm tired of living life like this, and we're welcoming you into the Christ Baptist family. Is there one? Never forsake you, no matter what. I want to remind you that tonight at 7 p.m. is our Fuel for Courage. It is a Zoom study. We invite you to come and be with us in our study tonight. Again, we're reminding you Tuesday night we're having an in-house Bible study. Call the church and make sure that we get you registered to be in here. The Zoom information will also be available to anyone. You can't make it out. You can't drive out. You don't want to come out. You can Zoom into the study with us on Tuesday. God, we thank you. We thank you, Lord God, that you do reveal the designs of the enemy. It is you, God, who activate someone who will come and inform us. If you do not do it by the power of your spirit, you have a way of letting us know what's going on. And God, you strengthen us because the promise of your grace resides inside of our hearts. Thank you today, God, that when conspiration occurs, when unlawful design is being created, you point it out and strengthen us, because you said you would never leave us nor forsake us. Now unto him was able to keep us from falling and present us fault before his throne with exceeding joy. Otherwise, God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever. People of God, say amen.
Amen. Thank you for joining Christ Baptist in Worship Fellowship. Remember, our Sunday night and Tuesday night Bible studies can be seen at 7 p.m. respectively. Meet us at www.cbcburlingtonnj.org or on YouTube at CBC Burlington in July. Christ Baptist members, don't forget, giving is an integral part of our worship. Simply go to the Give tab at the top of our webpage and follow the prompts. Or you can mail your tithes and offerings to Christ Baptist Church, P.O. Box 10, Burlington, New Jersey, 08016. We indeed look forward to when all God's children can get together in fellowship one more time. Until then, be blessed, be prayerful, keep trusting God.